for Underhill and Paul Martini of Canada. They went into the Olympics in 1984 favored to win a medal, but the competition for them turned out to be a disaster. And I asked them how they remembered Sarajevo.
We don't. We try not to.
It gets further and further away all the time.
It was just incredibly disappointing. It's nice because we had a chance to come back after that. And if we hadn't had that chance, I think it would have still been very hard to take. Now we look back on it as something that happened. It's a part of sport, and you can't do anything about it. It was a fluke, and you have to just put that behind you and move on. And it's very disappointing. Although we do have, you know, good memories of the Olympics, the competing part just wasn't one of them.
Their chance to atone came about a month later, and it came in their home country. As in Ottawa, they captured the 1984 World Championship.
I think more than anything was the chance to prove to ourselves, more than anyone, that we really could skate to win. That was really the biggest disappointment of Sarajevo. I think you look at an Olympic Games and you can walk away satisfied if you were able to perform to the best of your ability. And we didn't do that, and that was more frustrating than actually where we placed.
I asked them if their victory in Ottawa was more savored because of what had happened in Sarajevo.
Yes, because we had been on such a low that, I mean, within a month we were at the lowest point in our career to the absolute highest, all within 1 month. So it really came out well.
Now on the ice as professionals in Paris, Barbara Underhill and Paul Martini.
This is the music of Starlight Express. This is the train race.
Performed in the play on roller skates.
It's a pretty exciting play, I hear. Now this is a triple twist flip. Very nice, the speed that this couple gets when they're skating. Now here comes the throw axle. Watch the height that she gets. Beautiful. Audience is really turned on to this so far. What a drastic difference between what we just saw from the Protopopovs, their beautiful classical style, and now we are seeing the excitement, the speed, and difficulty of what pair skaters of today are doing. Foot injury. She had a cracked ankle. She was out of the show. She skates with Ice Capades. They were out of the show for 8 weeks, and I talked to her earlier, and it seems her ankle is back to normal and fit as ever. Really cute choreography. It was done by Sandra Bezic of Canada.
Still to come in this Paris competition, Kitty and Peter Carruthers.
Very nice. Forward, inside, death spiral. Now watch this back hand-to-hand press. Look at that extension she gives. It's beautiful. Real nice. That's a very difficult lift. Train race is coming to an end. They're real cute, isn't he? Well, they skated very well. Technically, they did the most difficult move so far. You know, it's a very clever routine, so we'll see what the judges have to say. And now here's his back press lift, where she just has to bounce just so to stay up there. Very difficult.
And now the score is coming up, and the first one for technical merit is a 10. A perfect mark in professional competition. The next a 9.9. And a 9.7. You don't see that very often. Quite a disparity between the 10 and the 9.7. Judge number 4 back to a 9.9. And another 9.9. So the 9.7 and the 10 are thrown out. That's 29.7 for technical merit for Underhill and Martini. Now they await artistic impression. The first mark is a 9.9. So is that one. And another 9.9. A fourth. And all five. Give them 9.9. Their total 59.4. They have the lead.
I take it you have to be pretty pleased with those marks.
Yeah, it was quite a good outing for us. The ice felt good, and the audience is finally getting into the whole competition.
I heard you also say the ice felt a little slow.
Yeah, I think we felt
slow. It's not bad. I mean, there's nothing wrong with
it. Yeah, there's nothing wrong.
Sometimes you get off and it feels fast. Sometimes you get off and it feels slow, but it's irrelevant.
How's your ankle?
It's coming along very well, thank you.
The crowd was really into it. Could you sense that in the middle of the routine?
Yeah, it kind of gets you going. Once you hear the crowd behind you, it really helps.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
A pair we'll see in Paris, Kitty and Peter Carruthers from Massachusetts. Now professionals, they won in 1981 the U.S. National Championships, succeeding Babylonia and Gardner, and then came this performance in Sarajevo in 1984, their final amateur performance, when they wound up winning, in a memorable finish, the Olympic silver medal. Their memories of Sarajevo.
Sarajevo was what we had been working for, I think, ever since we stepped on the ice. It was a dream come true.
Now that their amateur days are over, have they had the chance to pursue their other interests in life?
It's been something that has to be put aside for now, because we're young, we're very lucky to be in the position we're in. There's so many people fighting to get where we are right now. And so you have to, you know, at this age say, hey, look, my career is number one right now. And even though you've got that burn in the pocket to spend the money and to have the girlfriends and the boyfriends, I'm sure for Kitty is the same, we have to really be very devoted to one another right now. We want to be, because it's not going to last forever. So you want to take it while you can get it.
Now here they are on the ice trying to overtake Underhill and Martini.
Well, Kitty and Peter have their work cut out for them after the marks of Underhill and Martini. But they also do some very difficult moves technically. Nice extension on these camels into the back sit. This is the music from Jesus Christ Superstar. Now coming up is a throw triple salchow, one of the most difficult moves even being attempted here at this competition. Very nice. Now this is a move that they've invented. It's a lateral twist lift where she's spinning actually parallel to the ice. Very difficult. And side by side double toe loops. Very nice. Watch these flying camels. They're a little out of sync. Watch them do their rotations. They should be right with each other, but they're really not. Oh, hold the back of her head. Down. It's a great strength on the guy's part, but she also has to keep very rigid to give him something to control.
Performance by Kitty and Peter Carruthers. The crowd loves it. They look like they're pretty happy about it as well, and we'll find out shortly if they have overtaken Underhill and Martini.
Now it's really up to the judges as to how they're going to judge technically between Underhill and Martini and Kitty and Peter on the technical moves.
And here come the marks for technical merit. Two looking at the scoreboard, and the first thing they see is a 10. Kitty looks like she's surprised, but pleasantly, another 10. And a third. Somehow a 9-9 slips in there. And another 10. So that's perfect to throw out the high and the low, 110 and the 9-9, a total of 30 for technical merit. Now for artistic impression, a 10 there as well from Judge 1. Then a 9-9. Another 10. Still one more. That's a total of 7 10s. And a 9-9 and 59.9 for Kitty and Peter Carruthers. That's about as close to perfection as you can get. Were you expecting marks that high?
I'll tell you, Al, we have been just touring our brains out with Icecapades and getting these numbers together. It's been such a challenge, but Kitty and I have worked so hard together. And being over here with you guys again and remembering Sarajevo, it's just been a great, great day, great week.
How'd you feel about it, Kitty?
They're our first perfect marks we've ever gotten. We never got one in amateur, so I'm flying high. I wish everyone from home was here with us.
Were you inspired anymore by the fact that Underhill and Martini scored so well? You had a tough act to follow.
Oh, we are with them every time. Any of these people. Listen, you know, if I could make this point now, I'd like to do it. This is a competition. We all understand that. But at the same time, each person out here tonight has done something great at one time or another. It's nice to compete and everything, but I think people really have to keep perspective over what it's all about. We're all good friends. We're having a good time, and I'm just glad it's over. And
Ron had a good time. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Now, here are the final standings and the prize money. Peter and Kitty Carruthers win it. Underhill and Martini second. The Protopopovs third. And then Babylonia and Gardner. How does it feel to be $40,000 richer?
You're kidding. Who put you up to that? Who's been reading our contract?
Well, we've got the marks, and you're the winners.
Oh, my God.
It's great.
Babylonia and Randy Gardner, the two Southern Californians who lost out on a chance to win a medal at the 1980 Olympics because of his leg injury, but they were the 79 world champs.
Of course, this is the music to Slaughter on 10th Avenue from On Your Toes. This is the split double lutz. Their line is always so beautiful. Look at that extension. The strength that Randy must have to do these lifts with Ty. Look at this. She's not helping him at all. Okay, now coming up is her side-by-side double flip jump. May tap in and go two revolutions. Oh, Ty has missed it. She didn't even attempt the jump. So that's going to give her some trouble, I think, on their technical mark. Remember, the judges are judging on a technical mark of athletic ability and speed and strength and the quality of these moves and jumping and paralips and spins, and also on artistic impression of their musical interpretation and their originality and choreography. This all counts. Nice program. Ty did miss one of the pair jumps that they did together, so maybe their technical mark may be down a little bit, but their unison is still great.
At the age of 25, Randy Gardner, now 27. They've been skating together for 16 years. Crowd responding to the first performance in this pairs competition.
Now we're going to take a look at this very difficult lift. It's a back press lift. This is the only time where Ty really helps him. She's holding on to his hands. Normally, the girl would always be holding on and doing her extensions, but now she's going to let go. The only help she can give him is really to keep her body rigid, and the strength he must have is really incredible.
The scoring is done by five judges. You throw out the high and the low. 10 points is perfect, as opposed to six in amateur competition. So after the high and low are thrown out, the other three scores are added together as they look at their marks for technical merit.
Nothing.
A 9-9, the last mark. Throw out the high and the low. 29.2 is the total then for technical merit. Now artistic impression. 9-8, the first mark for Ty and Randy. A 9-9. Another 9-8. And still another. And one more for 29.4 for artistic impression, a total of 58.6 for Ty Babylonia and Randy Gardner. Now Robin Cousins of Great Britain. From Bristol, England, though he is spending a lot of time these days in New York City, he won the gold medal in the 1980 Olympic Games at Lake Placid. Always puts on a terrific show.
Al, he is such a character. I skated with him for 3 weeks at Radio City Music Hall a few years ago, and he always had me laughing. He's just great. Double axle, the speed that he continues to have after he does the jump, that is wonderful. And of course, fabulous footwork he does. Moves that always gets the audience going. Look at this, a backflip. Like this, I know the performers always love them. It gives the audience a chance to get to know their personality a little bit more. I don't know if anyone in the audience has picked this up, but this music is all synthesized music. There's not a conventional instrument in this whole piece.
I'm sure you can fool most of them.
It's great. Cute number.
A great ovation for a man who has been an extremely popular performer on the continent for some time. He's 28 years old now. Robin Cousins, the 1980 Olympic champion. A man who has performed in the European Championships on several occasions. Skated with Holiday on Ice between 1980 and 1982, and they love him at the Palais Omnisport in Paris.
Now we're going to take a look at his fabulous footwork. This is actually very difficult to do. It's a lot on his toes and very quick, very interpretive to this music.
And out for another bow is Robin Cousins. Still to come, of course, Dorothy Hamill and...
Very reminiscent of her spin. Nice double loop jump. And here she's going to go up into a Bielman again. This is a little different position. She can't stretch as far as the other way, and here she's going to do it all the way up. Look at this. The crowd really appreciates it. Change of mood and music. This is, of course, the fire dance. The length of these numbers are between 3 and 4 minutes, and they can go over if they'd like. Her choreography has always been on the edge of a little bizarre, even in her competitive programs when she was an amateur. A little acrobatics in here. Very nice.
And a warm response from a good-sized crowd at the Palais Omnisport for Denise Bielman. Naturally, our replay will feature one of the more unique moves in the history of this sport, really.
Al, no wonder this girl has a bad back. Doing a move like this is just incredible.
A chiropractor's dream, you would think. Now the score is 10 is a perfect score as opposed to 6 in amateur competition. Here are the marks now for technical merit. Are they looking for different things than they do in amateur competition here, Peggy?
No, they're looking for basically the same things. The difficult jumps and spins well executed. And the artistic mark, of course, is for choreography and originality and how you sell to the audience.
Now, the high and the low marks are thrown out. In other words, here, a 9-7 and a 9-9 go by the boards, and the other three scores are added together for her total for technical merit. Now come the marks for artistic impression. And again, the women are skating for a $40,000 first prize. So there is more than what you might call casual interest in the scores.
Oh, yes. Her marks seem a little bit high. It doesn't leave the judges very much room for the other skaters coming up.
You begin to wonder where we go from here because her total is very high, 58.9 out of a possible 60 for Denise Bielman. Another fabled landmark in this beautiful city of lights, the Cathedral of Notre Dame. To skate next here in Paris as Rosalind Sumners of Seattle, Washington gets ready for her routine. She really became familiar to many of us in 1982 as she skated her way to the first of 3 consecutive U.S. national championships. And thus, when she went to the Olympics in 1984, a lot of people expected her to come back with the gold medal. This was part of her performance at Sarajevo, Yugoslavia. She skated very well, but according to the judges, Katarina Witt of East Germany was better. Witt won the gold, Sumners the silver, and she reflects back on the Olympic Games.
I have a lot of mixed feelings about it. In a way, it was the height of my career, and it was the moment, at least that everyone said that I was building up to. But at the same time, it wasn't. I mean, I skated 13 years for each moment, and it's hard to put so much emphasis on one four-minute program, and that was where it all came down to in the end, was the last 4 minutes. And I skated for each accomplishment, not just for the Olympics. And it was the end of that career, and it was time to go on into a new phase of my life, and I knew that. And at the time, I didn't know what I was in store for, but it was kind of like being let out of a cage, and I was ready to start my life. So A lot of different feelings about that time.
Sounds like mixed emotions. I'm wondering, though, on balance, though, is it a happy thought? Is it a sad thought? Is it a bittersweet thought when you think back upon the Olympic Games?
I don't really think... there was so much pressure and there was so much muddling any kind of true feelings that I can't look back and just say it was sheer joy or that it was sheer unhappiness. There was too much, I think, pressure. I was trying to live up to too many expectations. There was too much going on that my true feelings couldn't come through. I was just trying to get through it, basically.
Coming up is a difficult jump, a double axel, 2.5 revolutions. Wow, that's beautiful. Nice and smooth. Watch this camel spin. She's doing outside circles. It's very difficult. It makes that spin go just a little slower so you can really look at that beautiful position. Double Lutz jump. Nice and smooth and confident. This number is really quite lovely. It was choreographed by Robin Cousins, and her costume was also designed by him. It's a beautiful look for Rosalyn.
She also credits Cousins with helping her mental outlook. She was under so much stress and pressure with the Olympic Games. Different situation now in professional competition. She really seems to be enjoying herself a lot more.
Yes, she really does.
So Cousins has been extremely helpful on several fronts as the crowd acknowledges this performance by Rosalind Sumners.
And this is a look at that camel spin again and that beautiful position you can get when you do those forward outside circles. It's a nice look.
So we've already seen Denise Bielman, whose total was 58.9. Now come the marks, technical merit for Sumners. And even though you know it's more enjoyable to skate under these circumstances, again, here she is in competition again because of that $40,000 prize money.
Oh, yes, the pressure never ends, it seems.
Her marks for technical merit, throw out 197 and the 99. Again, throwing out the high and the low and adding the other three. And now the marks for artistic impression. She was below Bielman for technical merit.
Well, Denise skated technically a very difficult program. She had a triple salchow in it, and Rosalind did not.
And her marks for artistic impression do not come up to Bielman's either. And thus, her total is 58.4. So Bielman is in front at the moment. Will be Dorothy Hamill, who's had a fabled career. Remember, 1974, the World Championships in Munich that year. Dorothy introduced to the crowd, began to cry because the crowd was booing and whistling. Unbeknownst to Dorothy, they were booing and whistling the scores given a previous competitor. Given time to regroup, she came back out onto the ice and won the silver medal. Then, the 1976 Olympics, Innsbruck, Austria. Dorothy Hamill winning the gold medal. And her amateur career was capped a month later, when in Sweden, she won the 1976 World Championships. So she's been around a long time, and I asked her if she still gets a little nervous when she performs on the ice.
Absolutely. It's not so little. It's major. I get so nervous. I don't think anybody, maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think anyone gets quite as nervous as I do of the skaters. I'm sort of known for that, you know, for being neurotic. I still get that, you know, stage fright. It's terrifying. It's terrifying. I don't know. I haven't learned the secret of overcoming that yet either.
Is it a fear of failure at all?
Not so much a fear of failure as wanting to skate the best I possibly can. I know what my abilities are, you know, if I'm good enough to win or not, even at my best. But it's just having pride in what you do and not wanting to and just wanting to be the best.
This is a new look for Dorothy, real happy, and she just looks great. This is to the music, of course, it's In the Mood by Glenn Miller. Nice double Falcao. The audience clapping along with the music, they're really into this. Double flip. Look at her straight back in these sit spins. This number was choreographed by Sarah Karahara, which Dorothy has her own show that tours around the country in small theaters, and she does this number on a small surface, so this is a nice change for Dorothy to get to really skate out. On that double toe, but I can relate to that. I think, you know, she won the Olympics in 1976, and the older you get, the harder those jumps are. Of course, that was her famous camel at the end. Great performance. Whoa.
And a special treat, I think, for those seated in the first few rows to simply watch Dorothy's facial expressions as she skates with an apparent renewed zest for this sport.
Yes, she really looks terrific. This is a slow motion look at her famous Hamel camel. It's actually a flying camel. And then watch her drop down into a back sit spin. And her straight back, it gives that sit spin a great look.
Now here come the scores. First, for technical merit, the crowd is whistling. They don't like the 9-7 issued by the first judge. Again, you're throwing out the high and the low and adding the other three scores. The leader right now is Denise Bielman, 58.9 total. 9-6 for Dorothy from judge four, and then a 9-9, so you throw out the 9-9 and the 9-6. and she is still trailing Bielman as far as technical merit is concerned. Now the marks for artistic impression. And a perfect 10 again. 10 is perfect in professional skating. 6 in amateur competition. Another 9.9, very high here. Yet another 9.9. And her second 10, her total is 59.1, and she moves ahead of Bielman and into the lead. The crowd was whistling, but I could hear you say that the marks were fair for technique first.
I think they're fair. I was a little wild out there tonight. But what the heck, you know, it's Paris. I had a wonderful time.
Peggy remarked that you seem to be happier skating now than she's seen you in quite some time. Is that true?
So much more. So much happier. I'm doing a whole lot of different things and really come to enjoy it again after a long time.
Enjoyable for everybody. Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Perhaps no more famous sight in the world than the Eiffel Tower. And we'll resume from Paris after this. Paris will be Linda Frattiani, who was the world champion in 1977, finishing first in the competition that year in Tokyo. She went on to win the world championship again in 1979. And then, at the Winter Olympic Games in Lake Placid in 1980, she skated to the silver medal. And the following year, they changed the scoring system. Had that system been in effect, she would have won the gold at Lake Placid. I asked her if she had any regrets.
I look back on the Olympics knowing that I had given it 100%, and I felt like I had skated all three segments of the competition the best I'd ever skated. And that's really all I can ask of myself, and I'm really happy and pleased with the way I did. And it's hard to hear that, but, you know, life goes on. I mean, there's more to life than a gold, silver, or bronze medal.
Clang, 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 winter trolley. Ding, 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 winter bell. Sing, sing, sing with my heartstrings. From the moment I saw my bell.
Watch these split falling leaves that she's going to do. Look at the split that she gets. Up into a double flip. The last 6 years, Linda has been skating with the Magic Kingdom on ice. She skates with them full time, 10 months out of the year. Here comes a planned double axel, but she elected to do a single. Linda looks very confident out there performing. She just seems to know how to look at that crowd and relax with it. She's quite enjoyable to watch. Half Wally split. Double toe.
As he started to leave, I took hold of his sleeve with my hand. And as if it were flesh, he stood up with me and he was proud to stand on his hand all in high. In the air of the
Frattiani, the four-time U.S. national champion, two-time world champion, and trying to capture this professional figure skating title and the $40,000 first prize.
Now we're going to take a look at one of the combinations she had in her program, a half wally, a split jump, and now a double toe loop, a 2.5 revolution jump, landing backwards. The judges are looking for that speed and control of all those landings and the flow coming out.
Now the marks. Dorothy Hamill is in first place right now, 59.1 out of a possible 60. The marks for technical merit appearing now. If there is a tie, by the way, overall, then the tiebreaker is artistic impression. Very consistent, 9.8s across the board thus far for Fradiani. And so her technical total, 29.4, is 1/10 higher than Hamill's. Now the marks for artistic impression. And they begin with a 9.9. A 9.8 there again. The high and the low will be thrown out. And the other three are added together. So you throw out 1.99, 1.98. Her artistic total is 29.7. Her overall total is 59.1. So she and Dorothy Hamill wind up in a tie at 59.1, but the tiebreaker being artistic impression gives Hamill the title. Thus, Dorothy goes home $40,000 richer. Linda Fradiani, second place, $20,000. Denise Bielman takes home $12,000. Rosalind Sumner's fourth, $8,000. So that concludes the ladies' competition. Coming up, of course, the men's competition featuring Scott Hamill, the 1984 Olympic champ and 1980 Olympic champ, Robin Cousins. Before that, when we come back, though, we'll have a very special look at a memorable moment from the past as ABC's Wide World of Sports celebrates its 25th year.
Record the world's first competitive triple Lutz jump. This is Donald Jackson of Canada. He's 21 years old. If he's going to win the world championship tonight, and many people had expected him to do it, he must give the greatest performance of his life. He's given many great ones.
He is going to open his program with a triple Lutz jump, three revolutions from a Lutz position, the first ever done in world competition. Let's see how he does it. He has planned it. Let's see what happens. Here it comes. A beautiful triple Lutz. It's fantastic.
You've just seen something that has never happened in world competition before. No man has ever done that maneuver before in the world championships.
Well, seeing the triple Lutz once again is brings back a lot of memories. I worked for, I guess, about 4 years off and on working on the triple Lutz. I landed four of them in the summertime, one at Christmas time, and then one at the world championship where it counted back in March. And fortunately, it was good enough to be able to give me seven perfect marks from the judges, which was enough to give me first place and win the world championship. The triple Lutz was only one jump in a five-minute program, but I guess it was a difficult jump to do at that time because it took 12 years before it was done again perfectly in the world championships. A lot of people before I went on the ice, they said, don't take the chance of trying it because, you know, if you fall, that is a competition. And I felt that if you're working for 4 years for something and you have your coach behind you 100% and you have the confidence to do it, give it a try. And so I tried it, and fortunately I landed. I was excited about it. I couldn't hear the music because, of course, the audience was so loud, but I could hear the music in my mind because I had trained myself to do that program so many times per day. And all I could think of at that time was, now I have to concentrate so that I don't trip on just any little nothing, any little step, because that could cost a competition. And I just had to just keep on thinking how I had to concentrate on the rest of the program, because the competition wasn't finished until I finished my five-minute program.
Don Jackson, his gamble in 1962 still rewards him in 1986. A quarter of a century of sports history. That's ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Professional figure skating's World Challenge of Champions continues. So the ladies' competition has concluded, and right now in Paris, we'll focus on the men. And I'm delighted to welcome for the first time Here at ABC, David Santee, who will serve as our expert commentator. He was known as America's skating Rocky and a man never afraid to make his own particular statement on the ice. So let me ask you to make a statement about the two featured performers we'll be looking at, Scott Hamilton and Robin Cousins.
Well, I've had the pleasure of skating against both men, and they're two distinctly different styles. Robin is a big play guy. If he were a quarterback, they'd probably call him the Mad Bomber, whereas Scott is technically superior. He's a craftsman. He's very quick and accurate, and it should be interesting to see what the judges do in comparing these two.
How will that translate into what we will see from their performances today?
Well, I think it's really going to be interesting to see what happens for the judges, because if both men skate to their potential, it's really like apples and oranges, and it just depends on what each judge is looking for, if they're looking for technique or if they're looking for style, and after that it'll just be up to the judges.
What's your feeling? Who's the better skater these days?
Well, I competed against both. I had my heart broken by both, and I'd have to say, if cornered, that I think that Robin is probably the one who would win.
And there are two other skaters as well, Tyler Cranston and this man who will start things off, Norbert Schramm of West Germany.
Norbert Schramm is kind of like the Steve Martin of skating. He's a real wild and crazy guy.
And he can afford to be even wilder and crazier if he wins this thing, because it's worth $40,000 to the winner.
The first jump of this program should give us a good indication of how he's going to perform. He's an all-or-nothing type skater, and the first jump he has planned is a triple Lutz. Here it comes. And he was off balance on the takeoff and elected to do a double. A little shaky on that triple toe loop landing. He's gonna need to be a lot sharper if he wants to be competitive with Scott Hamilton and Robin Cousins.
Not a particularly promising start when you want to go for a triple and then have to change your mind at the last moment.
Well, you could see going into it, he'd already slowed down his whole timing. He was a little bit cautious, and with a jump of that sort, you really have to go for it. Whoa! Looks like you... Skates and his body are not on the same track tonight. Babe, I love you. Norbert has always been known for his unique and different positions. You can see a good example of that in the spin. His plan, a triple flip coming up. Yeah. Just a little early again with the arms on that takeoff. Virtually every jump he's tried in this performance has been shaky on the landing. Always a crowd pleaser, though.
But as far as the competition is concerned, he really has his hands full.
Well, he's in big trouble already. I think the look on his face as he finished really said it all. Here comes what turned out to be a double Lutz. Watch how tilted he is on the takeoff. You can see his arms just a little bit earlier than everything else. And he was unable to do the three turns.
So it's a flawed performance for Norbert Schramm of West Germany as he awaits his marks again, as was the case with the women. 10 is a perfect mark as opposed to 6 in amateur competition. Scores were very high for the women, and again they begin quite high for SRAM, as you can see as well. They'll throw out the high and the low and add up the other three, so he gets 4.98 and a 9.9 for technical, and now the artistic mark.
Those are really much too high. The judges have really left themselves no room for the other three competitors.
You would think if you can make that many mistakes and come up with those marks that tens will be relatively cheap. And Fram winds up with a total of 58.7 out of a possible 60. Scott Hamilton, the 1984 Olympic gold medalist. Let's take a look at his lifestyle since that night in Sarajevo. Still skating and skating and skating. He's with the Ice Capade, and it's a real grind. 21 cities over a six-month period, normally six performances a week, and generally on the seventh day, he'll be bussing to the next city. He talks about the contrast between the amateurs and the pros.
Here, it's every night. It's not just putting all your energies into one performance. It's being consistent over 10 in 1 week. And it's a challenge. And, you know, you think about being up every day for your job, every day. Some days you don't feel like going into work. Some days you don't feel like going to school. Some days you just don't feel like getting out of bed. But you have a commitment, a responsibility. And once the lights hit you, it's like any mood that you were in coming into the building just disappears, and it's just go.
It's a nomadic life. The traveling group numbers about 75. And while some are on the ice, Scott waits backstage, killing time, reading mail, writing letters, sometimes playing poker. But he always has to be ready. Most days, two shows. On this particular day, three shows, the first starting in mid-morning.
10:30 in the morning is kind of become wake-up calls. You're out there, and your music comes on, and your body kind of goes, morning! And then it kind of, about halfway through, goes, didn't we just do this?
He'll skate nine times on this day, spending 13 hours at the rink. And then he'll bus to the next city and he'll do it all over again. Not quite the glamorous life many of us think that an Olympic champion would lead.
It's a balance. It's, I'm not saying it's a job, it's a career. And I'm really enjoying it. There's a lot of things that I wish, you know, you always want something you can't have. So I wish I had a couple more days off a week or one week off, you know, every 2 months or something like that. I'd like that, just to let the body heal up a little bit. But, you know, it's great. It's wonderful. I'm enjoying it, and hopefully I'll be able to do it for a long time.
Now the vagabonding Hamilton skating to Amazing Grace.
Leading off with a nice delayed axel, nice arm position on the landing. I think Scott would rather be skating behind Robin Cousins than in front of him because, as I know competing against Scott, he likes to know what he needs to do to win. So it's pretty much up to him here.
Might it make him more or less aggressive skating in front of the man that he knows he has to beat?
My conscience would tell me that I think he would be less aggressive skating in front of Robin because he would be afraid to make a mistake and leave the door open. When he skates after Robin, he knows exactly what he has to do and he'll be more aggressive.
Mm-hmm.
coming up to the most difficult jump in Scott's program, a triple Lutz. Right there. Axel. Solid landing. Triple Taloup. He's always in complete control of all his jumps. Scott's answer to Robin before Robin even skated. Robin is known for his backflip. I'm not really sure that that backflip went with the music, though. It's kind of, music is nice and slow, and that's really an exciting, fast move. Crowd certainly loved it. And you can't argue with the cleanness of the program. Everything was solid. Now, let's watch that backflip again and watch his knees come up to his chest. If you get the knees in, the rest is really easy.
I'm going to move in for a word with Scott as soon as we see his marks.
Do you believe in miracles?
Yes.
Well, you may not need any here after that performance. The scores were relatively high for Schramm's performance, so for Scott Hamilton, it's really not that surprising that the first mark for technical merit is a perfect 10. As is the second. And the first three are 10s. And this will really put a lot of pressure on Robin Cousins. A 9-9. The crowd whistles and boos. And another 9-9. So you throw out 110, 19.9. And a near perfect technical mark for Scott Hamilton. Now for artistic impression. A 9-9. Another. Scott acknowledging Judge 3 for that perfect score. Another 10. And another. 59.8 the total. Scott, first, tell me about your selection of Amazing Grace.
Oh, it means a lot to me. And I've been doing it for a couple years, and it's a program that I have a lot of faith in. No pun intended, but it's something that really I feel good skating to. And I was really comfortable. I picked it here tonight because I felt most comfortable.
You had the option, too, of going with the rock and roll number.
Well, I had a lot of options. I just wanted to feel comfortable, and again, this is new, so you never know how they're going to judge, so you just kind of go with what feels comfortable.
Was the backflip a message to your competitor?
Well, I didn't want him to have anything up on me, you know, so I did one, he does one, we'll see, you know, whether they like him better or me, who knows.
It'll be tough to beat. Congratulations, Scott.
Thanks a lot.
The beautiful Arc de Triomphe in Paris, where our competition will resume after this. Has the lead, and now it's up to Robin Cousins to try to overtake him. He'll be the next competitor to skate here in Paris. Cousins, from England, still spends half the year there and the other half in New York. Robin Cousins, the 1980 Olympic gold medalist in Lake Placid, talks about his current lifestyle.
I'm doing some guest work with Icecapades. I'm now also trying to be a little more involved with some commercial ventures that are maybe not skating. I'm also choreographing for other skaters, costume designing. So I'm dabbling a little bit more, and I'm using my time and certainly some of the friends that I've made in New York City to try and widen my scope, if that's the right word. And I certainly find that for those types of things, New York is a lot more accessible for me than back in Bristol in England. I'm traveling to and from London fairly often when I'm home, but I still find that things happen or a lot easier to happen in New York maybe than they would be in England. My home is still very much Bristol, where my parents still live. And not only was I able to help my parents move into what I consider a very comfortable, beautiful home, it's also big enough to cope with the whole family, which is wonderful. And we've had a few occasions where there have been both of my brothers, myself, mum and dad, and the three children as well. So it's quite a wonderful setup. And it's very much the type of place that make my parents happy, and I think that's very important. They've sacrificed a lot, not just for myself, but also for my brothers, for Martin and Nick. And they still continue to be actively involved with the family. And it's very nice. That's partly, I think, the three of us would say that was partly their reward as well.
As far as pro skating is concerned, Cousin skates in limited engagements with the Icecapades, quite in contrast to Hamilton, who skates on a much more regular basis.
I just saw Scott recently with Icecapades, and it's been 3 or 4 years since I myself skated with and toured with a big show. And it's tough. It really is tough. I don't think people realize quite how hard it is to say, make yourself go out every night because you want to do it, but to be what people expect you to be. And I think that's the toughie, is that people have paid to see the Olympic champion, they've paid to see Scott, or they had paid to see me, that they have a preconceived idea of what you are going to do for them, and they have to be satisfied, otherwise you will know it.
A veteran of the sport at the age of 28, he has these thoughts on performing in competition.
There are so many aspects to professional performing, the actual technical side of skating aside, that I wouldn't like to be the judge who had to differentiate between Scott, Tyler, myself, Dorothy, Peggy, whoever. I think it's obviously very difficult. Again, we have to be 100% upfront and know that it's personal preference.
Now in Paris on the ice, Robin Cousins, who in his most recent head-to-head confrontation with Scott Hamilton, defeated Scott. He'll try to do it again.
Robin will need a perfect performance to beat Scott. Scott's marks were close to perfection. It'll be interesting to see how Robin handles the pressure. He's opening with a double axel. One thing to watch for in Robin's performance is his use of his big moves to build up to a climax toward the end of the program. Triple toe ollie. Elected to do a double. That could be the ball game. Interesting variation on the spiral, going from front to back. Robin skate is to sense the complete control he has over every part of his body. incredible power he gets on each stroke. Here's an axle landing in a sit position. Elected to change that. Comes Robin's answer to Scott, his backflip with the legs straight in the air. Really an outstanding move. And the use of his backflip went perfectly with the music as it built up to a crescendo. That was the one thing that Scott did not do. Down on the landing of that double axle. If Robin gets beat tonight, it will be on technical merit. Because the program has been masterfully skated. Just in complete control throughout.
As it turned out, an advantage or a disadvantage to have skated second?
Well, a disadvantage having to follow the perfectly executed triples of Scott Hamilton. The one triple that Robin had planned, he elected to do a double, and really after that point, it really was all over. No question about who the crowd favorite is, though.
Robin,
let's watch Robin's backflip one more time. What makes his backflip different from anyone else in the world is the fact that he does not pull his knees in. He does it with a straight leg, much more difficult and spectacular looking. Now here comes Robin's double axel. You'll watch the touchdown on the landing. Alone, this is not a big mistake, but if you combine it with the fact that he did not do a triple and Scott did three, I think the mistake is enormous.
And we'll find out just how enormous it is as the moment of truth has come. The first mark is a 10, and Cousins almost looks embarrassed to have received that perfect figure. Now a 9.9. Another 10. Remember, Hamilton had a total of 59.8. A third 10. He appears to be in disagreement. He doesn't think he has skated that well, but nonetheless, he'll accept it. That's a perfect technical mark when you throw out the 9.9. 30 for Cousins there. Hamilton scored 29.9. Now for artistic impression, a 10. Hamilton had three 10s, two 9.9s. That's the second 10 for Cousins. And another. One more would clinch it, and there it is, a fourth 10. And this one is academic. Robin Cousins has moved ahead of Scott Hamilton. In your career, have you seen 9.10s?
Well, last week I got straight 10s, and I felt I deserved them there, maybe a little more than I did here. I think they were being very nice to me today.
Were you confident that your marks were better than Scott's when you came off the ice?
No, not at all. No, I saw the last minute of Scott, and I really felt that... the way that I felt going onto the ice, I didn't know that I would be able to produce what I had last week, and I thought he had nailed it. And I think maybe because I thought that he had it, I wasn't quite myself.
But, did you alter your routine at all, knowing what his marks were?
No, you forget that the minute you start your program, but I just know that I felt that I had a hard task ahead of me, and I didn't quite have it in me when I was out there. But they've given it to me, so...
Nastable performance. Congratulations. So Robin Cousins on the verge now of being able to take a cook's tour of this beautiful French capital on the doorstep of a $40,000 first prize. Tyler Cranston next. Skater we'll see today. He has always been extremely outspoken, doesn't mince words, and here are his thoughts on the state of the sport today.
The problem today is that the skaters are basically one-dimensional, and that is that they're concentrating on only one aspect of skating, as opposed to being the complete skater, which means being an artist, being an athlete, being innovative, being classical, beautiful, funky. I mean, all of those elements must manifest themselves in skating, and with the skating that we see in the World Championships today, it seems to be only a competition of jumps.
We asked Cranston what steps he would take to change the system.
Basically, to totally review the way that skating is judged internationally. You see, judges are too afraid to mark a skater that is so consummate technically. They're very afraid to mark them down, if artistically. And I think that the whole system of judging has to be reviewed. And I think that people have to be a lot gutsier with the way that they evaluate skaters. A skater could be at a 5.9 technically. What's to say that they couldn't be at a 4.9 artistically? A good example would be Katarina Witt, who artistically, one is hard-pressed to find anything about her that is artistic. But if we watch the World Championships this year, her artistic marks will be 1/10 lower than the technical. This is where it's got to change.
The outspoken Cranston, who right now is really engaged as we pick up his routine in progress, David, in an exercise in futility of sorts, because the perfect mark has already been turned in by Robin Cousins, and Cranston really with no chance to win. But still, always an interesting man to watch on the ice.
And now watch the extension on these split jumps, really second to none. The problem right now is that after you've had two incredibly exciting performances, the level of intensity with the crowd, you know, is dropping. And a Tyler Cranston of 10 years ago probably could have maintained that intensity. But right now it just feels like he's lost that a little bit. Tyler's signature ending of Pagliacci.
A unique performer, Canada's Tyler Cranston.
Tyler really changed the face of skating in the 70s with his boldness and his courage to change his style and do something totally different.
And so he has wrapped up this competition in Paris, and we'll have the final results when we come back. Perfect 60 and a $40,000 top prize. Hamilton second, Cranston third, Schramm fourth. The scores from the first routine today were inordinately high. Only one mark in the entire competition under 9-7, and I'm with the chief referee, Didier Gayagé.
In the Olympics or in the World Championships, I think the public's been ingrained to think that if somebody does miss a move, that a tenth of a point or maybe even 2/10 of a point will be deducted. Are we to assume that in a competition like this, if a move is missed, that somebody can still get a perfect score?
I agree. I think they should get a perfect score because they do so many great things that if you miss one jump, one spin, that's not bad. But the rest of, you have to look to the rest of the performance, the overall performance. And that's what the judge tried to do tonight.
So I do take it from your summation then that you are satisfied with the scoring system the way it is.
Oh, I like it very much. It's 10 times better than the amateur system.
Thank you, sir.
All right, well, David, now you've heard what Didier had to say. Do you think that the scoring system has to be changed?
Well, I feel that there's no way you can reward a less-than-perfect performance with a perfect mark. Robin will be the first person to agree that he was not perfect tonight, and especially technically, there's no way that he should have received a 10 for technical merit. He was not perfect.
We heard earlier Tyler Cranston say that the whole system needed to be reworked and needed to be reworked in a relatively drastic way. Do you think that sort of measure is needed?
Well, absolutely. I agree with Tyler in that the marking should have started a lot lower. You can't, again, reward someone with high marks when the job that they're doing is not equal to the mark. You know, all the way down the line, I think that the marks were just too high. And, you know, if the marks were lower, then I don't think the judges would feel that they were boxed in. There just was nowhere to go.
All in all, though, a very enjoyable performance turned in before this large crowd at the Palais Omnisport. Now this is Al Michaels for David Santee and Peggy Fleming saying goodbye from Paris. The coordinating producer of ABC's Wide World of Sports is Dennis Lewin, who also produced today's show, which was directed by Doug Wilson. Coordinating director, Carol Letty. Associate producer in Paris, Marianne Grabovoy. Associate director, Joe Novello. Stay tuned for ABC's World News Saturday over most of these ABC stations. Tomorrow, join us for the International Players Tennis Championships, followed by ABC's Wide World of Sports, featuring US-USSR boxing from Moscow and special performances by pairs figure skating champions from Paris. Travel arrangements made through and a promotional fee paid by United Airlines, now serving 13 cities throughout Asia and the Pacific. United, a fresh breeze across the Pacific.
Spanning the globe to bring you the constant variety of sport, the thrill of victory, and the agony of defeat. The human drama of athletic competition. This has been ABC's Wide World of Sport.
Brought to you by Budweiser, Beechwood Age for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. By Milford Plaza Hotel, the lullaby of Broadway. And by Travelers, one of America's strongest, most experienced financial experts.